I want to get you ready to go in a certain direction in a few moments. We'll visit the book of Acts chapter 2 in a few moments because of the significance of the day. It would be like on Easter not talking about the resurrection if you didn't talk about the resurrection on Easter, because Easter's nothing without the reality of the resurrection. And honestly, the church is dead without the power of the Holy Ghost. But the church is not dead because the Holy Ghost is very much available and accessible in 2021. I want to use for a subject today, actually started a series last week called Leaders Made Here, not leaderships. We'll let someone else make the ships, but Leaders Made Here. Today can be part of that, but it certainly might also be a standalone. Because it's a special day. It's a revival weekend. It's Pentecost Sunday. It's a day where we celebrate a power, source, and release from God different for every believer, to give the believer the reality of a life as if you had Jesus within you always. Because through the Holy Spirit, we have access to the ways of Jesus within us. I want to call today's message Happenings on Pentecost. Happenings on Pentecost. And I want you to listen to these opening remarks before I take you to Scripture this morning. In this hour, if the real, authentic genuineness of the church has ever been needed, and it's always been needed, but it's desperately needed now in a way that I don't even know how to fully express. Because, well, let's just look at America. Our nation has never been at a more critical mass. Think of what I'm saying. If we try to do things in this nation and keep pushing God away, now you expect the world to do that, but if we keep trying to push God away, I don't even want to think about the fallout of that. But I know that God already knew the kind of things we would be facing in this hour, because so much of it has been prophesied. And that being said, there's never been a greater need for the obvious reality of Pentecost. Now, you got to understand, if we don't get the beginning of Pentecost, then we don't get the continuance of Pentecost. If we don't experience the way the move of God started, that He has not changed. There's certain things God has not changed. He's certainly built upon. He's certainly expanded, but He has not changed. And we need in 2021 an obvious Pentecost, a fruit-filled Pentecost, a demonstration of the Spirit of God in power, not only through preachers, but we sure need it through preachers, but through the laity, the body of Christ. We need men to be operating in the power of the Holy Spirit. We need women operating in the power of the Holy Spirit. We need teenagers operating in the power of the Holy Spirit. One young man sitting in this room today looked at me and said something to me yesterday, as we had gathered with a group of men, and he said it, and I don't even know if he realized the impact it would make on, and I might have been the only one who heard him say it, but he made the statement. He said, your whole world can change in a moment. He made that statement. Your whole world can change in one moment. It can change in one day. And that is an absolute truth. November of 1983 was a month and a day and a moment that changed my life forever. Forever. Radically saved by the blood of Jesus and by the power of God. But about a year after that, realizing God has more, I wish you would turn to someone and say, God always has more. Realizing that God had more for me after seeking Him and yearning for Him and longing for Him, ignorant in certain areas, but knowing I had Bible promise. certain things I didn't understand. But what I did know is I wanted what God had for me, and I realized that it was going to take His power, His outpoured Spirit, the move of His Spirit, for me to be able to become what He wanted me to become. And I had no idea something else would happen that I wish more people talked about, because I believe it would cause many people that are narrow-minded about the Holy Spirit to open their heart and open their mind more. Because on that day, after wanting to be filled with the Holy Spirit, baptized in the Holy Spirit, let me say it this way. The day that I received, I had no idea that one of the major things that would happen in my life, as already having been born again now for about a year. And by the way, it only took me a year because I was in my own way. Ignorance held me back. I wasn't stupid. Smarter than a lot of people I've met. But how do you know you can be smart and ignorant? Ignorance just means you don't know. I didn't say I'm the smartest guy that ever was. Now, I ain't going to go lying. But I just didn't know. So it took me longer. I had some hindrances in my life. I had some mindsets in my life. I had some things that I thought in my mind God had to do a certain way before He could or would do. And I want to set you free from all that today. Don't you pre-think nothing. Don't you get to thinking so much that you think yourself right out of what God wants to do. What you need to do is be totally open in your mind, in your spirit, and in your heart to God. Because on that day when He filled me with His Spirit, what I did not realize would happen is I fell more in love with Jesus than I ever have before in my life. I did not just get some new rush that made me want to be just merely a radical screaming, hopping, jumping, shouting, wild expressionist, you know, type person that some people equate Pentecostal folk with. Man, I was so in love with Jesus, I thought to myself, I didn't know that I could love Him more because He had been so good to me. It was my love for Him that wanted to receive the more of Him that He promised. But when He filled me with the Holy Spirit that day, it was as if, I don't know how to say it any other way, and this is just my description, okay? It was like He double-dipped me in His love. A love that won't quit. A love that don't want to quit. A love that doesn't have to quit. A love that never quit on me. Are you hearing what I'm saying? A love that believed in me. A love that reached me. A love that keeps on reaching me. Are y'all in this room with me today? I can't just get away from that too fast, because it was like I was literally baptized in love. And that's a phrase I'm creating, okay, to describe what happened. But when I was filled with His Spirit, I mean, never had I experienced at that point in my life more of Jesus than I did in that moment. And there's a lot of people, due to their camp mindsets and their denominational mindsets and their theological mindsets, and real theology should always be judged by this book rather than the opinions of different camps. Look, I've studied under a lot of people that have blessed me. I've received from a lot of people that don't have all the same theological views that I do. But when it comes right down to what the Bible says and what somebody else says, I'm always going to tilt back toward what God says. Because God is God, and none of us are. And God is right, and God is good, and God's not scared, and God's not afraid, and God's not an old cold wet blanket. Our God, Hebrews says, is a consuming fire. Listen in the book of Acts today. Acts chapter 2, look at verse 5. I told the team I would go to verse 1 at some point, but I'm going to begin with verse 5. Acts chapter 2, verse 5, there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. Covers a lot, doesn't it? And when this sound occurred, what sound? We'll talk about it in a little bit. the multitude came together. That's interesting. Drew the multitudes, drew the masses together. These are lost people, by the way. They're people who had some understanding or idea of God, but these are people who do not know about Jesus. The multitude was drawn together, but they were confused because everyone heard them speak in his own language. The confusion was, is how are they doing this? The confusion was not what they were doing, but how are they doing this? A devilish confusion is confusing in every way. The confusion is, what doesn't make sense to me is I know these people are not trained and skilled like this by themselves. How are they doing this? Verse 7, then they were all amazed and marveled. Ooh, been there, done that, buddy. Has anybody in this room besides me ever had God amaze you and marvel you? Then why should it surprise us that in 2021 he still amazes and he still marvels? I believe God so much that I believe he's not just a good historical God who did things, but I believe he's a God who does things. I still get amazed and I still get marveled. And if you've hit a place in your life when you no longer are amazed or marveled, it is because somehow or another you have jumped ship from a move of God. But today it's time to get back on board. If you've jumped ship, and I don't mean my ship or your ship, I mean what the old church called the ship of Zion, meaning the way of the church following in the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Saying to one another, look, verse 7, are not all these who speak Galileans? Well, how is it that we hear each in our own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, pardon me, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. Folks, the Holy Ghost can fix the Middle East. Don't shout me down while I'm preaching good. Some of you won't even grunt this morning. Come on, let's at least do something. Amen. The Holy Ghost can change the Middle East. The Holy Ghost can change old squeaky religious Grenada, Mississippi that I love. I don't see it that way. You did pull your head up out the mud. There's a lot of great people. There's a lot of great believers. But there's a whole lot of people who grab hold to one thing and say, I believe this and this is all I believe. And God is saying, if you will turn me loose in your life, if you will give place to me, I will show you things and reveal to you things about me and show you my ways like you never even dreamed could be. We hear them, verse 11. When you hear Arabs, it gets exciting, which means people can be saved out of anything. They can be saved out of false religion. They can be saved out of perversion. They can be saved out of drugs. They can be saved out of hypocrisy. They can be saved out of complacency. They can be saved out of anything. Are you hearing me? God can save people out of anything. Anything. Man can't, but God can. I am persuaded that mankind knows what it wants to know and leaves out a lot. But I'm persuaded that God knows what he wants us to know. And he loves this world enough to heal it if we'll listen to him. We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were all amazed, all of them. And they were perplexed, like, because God will rock your world sometimes. If you want a faith where God never blows you away, what do you want? What are you? I need a God. I need a true God that astounds me. I need God to do the kind of stuff that has me thinking, I never thought you would do it that way. Because here's the thing, I'm an honest man. There's some things that if God doesn't do it, it's not going to happen. Only God can do it. But I've been living for Jesus. Hard to believe somebody this young has been living for God this long. But I've been living for Jesus for quite some time. And I've seen only God who can, only God can do it again and again and again and do it in different ways and have me shaking my head, perplexed. And I didn't know you would do it that way. But my perplexity was not that he did it. My perplexity was that I knew if he didn't do it, what would occur? You that are always going to lean over to your own self. You're trusting in your flesh. You're trusting in your flesh. You better let that go. Peter doesn't walk on the water if he doesn't trust the power of God. David does never becomes the darling of Israel if he doesn't trust the power of God. David doesn't slay Goliath if he doesn't trust the power of God. Simon Peter never becomes the giant in the faith that he would become, and he never quits fishing for fish and starts fishing for men if he doesn't trust God. Look at someone and say, only God can do it. Yep. But he can. He can. See, that's the whole thing. He wants you depending on him and leaning on him. Yep. They were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, whatever could this mean? They start asking questions. What does this mean? Whatever could this mean? What's going on here? What's happening here? So not everybody there that day is trying to find fault with what's going on. Some are just trying to understand. Some are wanting to know. But there were some who were mocking. Been mocked too. But you know, it's kind of exciting to think that God's doing something on the inside of you, working in your life to such a degree that people can tell it. And they are even willing to attack it because it's not happening in their life. Or they think it's excessive or crazy. But it's an odd thing to spend a lot of time listening to somebody who thinks certain things of God happening in your life are excessive and crazy. But if you look at their life, their whole life is crazy. The others mocking said people are the most screwed up among us in our culture. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. I'm preaching better than you're letting on. I'll say it. You Holy Ghost straight, I'll say it. The others mocking said, the ones who, they mock, the move. Oh, that's crazy. You mean you go to that tongue-talking church? I want to say, you don't. You believe in that? You don't. You believe in all those miracles? You don't? I don't want to say, God, I do. Don't judge me. I don't feel that way. I don't think I'm cock of the walk, but I don't feel like I'm scared of what you'll think about me. Because if all you ever get is Chris Owensby's best, your life ain't going to change anyway. But if you get the best of God, your whole world can change. I am not here today to preach what Chris Owensby or Way of Life has discovered by getting some pretty cool end time ideas together and making some things click. I want you to know that this church, Way of Life, was born in the midst of a move of God, depending upon the help of the Holy Spirit. And I'm on the side that says, it's pretty cool. As much as my flesh at one time would have freaked a little bit, it's pretty cool to have something enough to be persecuted for a right reason. Some people get persecuted for being stupid. Don't shout me down. Some people get persecuted over stuff that they create and they try to make it spiritual. But I'm telling you, if I am to be persecuted because I believe that God can do anything because of the different things he's done in me, I don't just believe he can do anything because of what I've read in the Bible. I know what it's like to have my feet hurting so bad. And I had to have had heel spurs. And I remember preaching every night of my life and preaching in pain and praying for other people and God touching them and helping them and ministering to them. And here I am preaching in pain overweight, by the way, at that point in my life, preaching in pain. So that didn't help a whole lot. I mean, and it felt like I had barbs going up into my, I mean, nails, better said, going up into the bottom of my feet. And one day, the Holy Spirit said, you sit down and have the church pray for you. And I thought, well, Lord. He said, there's the part that made me nervous. He said, take your shoes off. Why are you looking at me funny? I'd be nervous if some of you took your shoes off. Some of you slow or just have a bad personality. I don't know. I wash real good, but I've had some people in my presence take their shoes off. And you thought, bring out the masks. No, hey, drop the mask joke. Drop the mask joke. I retract the mask joke. Don't bring out no mask. Just this year turkey hunting, I didn't even wear my mask at times. If he sees me, he sees me. Maybe the beard will work. I'm never going to get done if I don't. The good news is this. The good news is this. The church can be so powerful. The church can experience the happenings of God. The true church can be so powerful. And here's the thing. He's not going to make us all be exactly alike, but he will mold us into being the best that we can be. And no one should feel threatened by the Holy Ghost. You should feel threatened is if somebody in a position like mine robs you from the privilege and the opportunity of receiving the Holy Ghost. And I make this commitment to you. As long as I'm alive, you'll never be robbed of that opportunity. And I would say to you now, I'm going to put it in your lap. And while you have this opportunity, don't let anything try to barge you out of your moment. If it's the others mocking said crowd, it's okay. Remember before you got saved? You had some people that didn't like you too. You had some people that said some stuff to you. I mean, I had some people say some stuff to me in my BC days that were harder than what has been said about me. But I don't know what it is about now that you become a child of God. Your skin gets a little bit thinner and you begin to get a little too touchy. I want some evidence in my life that's worthy of a little good persecution. Don't like persecution. Don't enjoy it. I'm not asking for it. But if there's some evidence of the happenings of God in my life that merit it, cha-ching, then I receive that. Now turn back a little bit. Let's go back to verse 1. Verse 1. I'm going to preach a bit more and share a few things with you. There's so much to share. And we got some guys loaded with fire and dynamite for tonight, the things they're going to share. But again, these are happenings on Pentecost. What happened? Verse 1. These people are being transformed. Their lives are being impacted. They're hearing the wonderful works of God. How? Because of what happened in verses 1 through 4. 5 through 13 is impacted by verses 1 through 4. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. First happening I want you to see before we begin to close this message. I've got 6 to share with you. I'm going to touch them quickly. The first happening right there, they were in one accord, they were in one place, and they were gathered together. One accord. They were choosing to be in agreement. One place. They decided, hey, look, this is what Jesus said. And this is what we're going to do. And we're going to gather. And we're going to do exactly what he says. I don't know what the promise of the Father is. I just know he said, wait for the promise of the Father. I don't know everything that's about to go down on this day. But I do know this much. I like what's coming up in my life. And whatever's about to go down by God, I am open for this. And so, number one, first happening, they're in one mind, one accord, one place, together. So these people who say, you know, I can have mine all separate by myself, you wouldn't have got Pentecost that way. One mind, One place. Unity. God did not pour out of His Spirit in one mighty blast at a guy out fishing on Grenada Lake by himself that day. Or a guy out visiting the Green family on holy ground by himself. Or a woman out on an individual shopping frenzy out by herself. No, He strategically poured out His Spirit on a people. Because He wanted to do it in the midst of a people. He didn't just want to do it for a peep. He wanted to do it for people and in people and with people. So number one, the first happening we point out, one accord, one place, gathered together. Number two, there was a willingness to wait, a hunger demonstrated. 10 days of expectation. What we don't realize is, these people, 500 or so new to be part of this group, 120 are the ones, the amount that received what was about to happen when this event happened. But they were so willing, they were willing to wait. 10 days of prayer. 10 days of yearning for God, asking God for that He doesn't fill in all the details yet. But if you hang with God long enough, He'll take care of the details. He'll take care of the details. He might not give you all the details up front, but He will take care of the details. And there'll be good things in the details. And if He spares any details, just be grateful. But He'll bring in the necessary details. And they're waiting. They're seeking. And when the time comes, they were sitting. They were sitting. I don't know if they'd been sitting the whole time. If that had been me, they wouldn't have been. I couldn't sit for 10 days. But I could stay. I might not have been able to sit for 10 days. I might not be, but I could have hung with it. Because when God makes a promise, He's worth the wait. The willingness to wait, the hunger was demonstrated. 10 days of expectation. Then look at verse 3. Verse 3 is good, but let's read verse 2 first. The next happening on Pentecost, there was suddenly heaven changed everything. At verse 2, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. It didn't just happen in the corner over by the window. Because this was an upper room that I'm pretty sure had no windows in it. This was a gathering place that's different, but suddenly heaven changed everything. Glory to God. Whew. I looked around for just a moment, and it's very unusual what just happened to me just then. I looked around the room, and I thought, at moments where I've seen God suddenly change everything in different ones of your lives. That's not in my notes. That wasn't in my thought. That wasn't going to be one of my points, but I happened to be privileged to be there in those suddenly moments. I remember when a number of you got baptized in the Holy Ghost. I was there when a number of you gave your life to Jesus Christ. I happened to be in an atmosphere where different ones of you gave your marriage over to Jesus, and Jesus did a miracle with it. Glory be to God. I'm looking at some of you, and I can remember when you laid down at the altar things that were killing you. You laid down weights and sins, and you said, I want to be delivered, and I'm looking at you now. Suddenly, God changed everything, and He did it by His power and Spirit. And that was not in my thoughts nor in this message, but it is in this message. Because the happenings of Pentecost are perpetual. And suddenly, God can change everything. He can change it quickly. Heaven, notice, the sound came from heaven. It didn't come from hell. It didn't come from man. It came from heaven. And it filled the entire place there. Number four, individual and corporate outpouring at the same time. What do you mean? Verse 4, they were all filled. Verse 3, then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire. Notice, and one sat upon each of them. Now think about this verse. Think about this verse. Think about this verse that even a lot of Pentecostal people or Spirit-filled people read right past. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. Everyone received an individual experience. And at the same time, everyone received a corporate experience. Some of the greatest things God's ever done in my life was with people like you around. And he did it in a way, it's almost like he just came out of heaven. We sometimes want to say God came out of nowhere. God always comes out of somewhere. He just comes out of heaven in a different kind of a way sometimes. Would you give him a hand clap and a shout? Give him a hand clap and a shout. Give him a I love you all. Woo, Jesus. Individually and corporately, I mean, every one of them. And none of them was sitting there thinking about a prayer language. Not one of them. Well, none of them thinking about, I wonder what my prayer language is going to sound like. They wasn't even thinking about a prayer language. They didn't even know to relate tongues to what Jesus was saying until after they received. And they think, oh, that's what he meant when he said this. That's what Isaiah meant in the 28th chapter and the 11th and 12th verses. They were not sitting there meditating on what their prayer language would sound like. They were waiting on the promise of the Father, and the same God who had lit their heart on fire, tongues of fire, flames of Holy Ghost fire, come down on every one of them and all of them. One and all, and that's why it's important to be part of an on-fire church. I said that's why it's important to be part of an on-fire church. Hallelujah to the Lamb. There's some things, it's just way easier for us to receive when we receive together. There's some things it's just easier for us to take when we take it together. If we're going through a hard time, it's easier if we go through it together. If it's the valley of the shadow of death, it's easier if we go through it together. How many times have you been standing at a casket and someone you love is there and you could go through it by yourself, but then some people who love God and love you and have walked with this in this journey with you and stood by you, they come near and they don't try to just bombard you with a bunch of scriptures, but they wrap their arms around you and they tell you that they love you and they encourage you. Folks, I'm telling you, it's amazing what God can do in the midst of a hungry people that are open to him, waiting on what he says and giving place to his promise. And they, verse 4, were all filled. You want to know one of the reasons why? Because none of them were against what was happening. They were for what was happening. If God is doing it now, I am for it. And if God didn't say he's done with it now, you might ought to quit saying he's done with it. Whoever you may be. They were all filled. What does all mean? All means, that's all it's ever going to, because all means, and that's all it'll ever mean. Very good. Always. Thank you. That's good preaching. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. At one point, listen to me. Let me show you something that'll bless you if you're open. At one point, they receive what Jesus said, a new tongue's coming to your life. Individually, Jesus said, he told them in Mark's gospel where he shares with us the Great Commission, they shall speak with new tongues. This was one of the things he meant in that. He wasn't just meaning to talk about Jesus in a different kind of a way. Absolutely. But they will speak with new tongues. You meet Jesus, you were talking a different way just upon being born again. You get baptized in the Holy Spirit. You receive help to your prayer language. But that'll work. Help with a prayer language to increase the language of prayer in your life, which is way more than tongues. It's scripture. It's agreement. It's a lot of different things. But it's also, how do I say this, Lord? How do I say this? On that day, they would be heard by people that the people knew, these people don't know my language. So not only are they being edified individually, but they're preaching the gospel and they don't even know it. They're being used in a way that only a yielded life can be used. See, while I know there are some that they get so caught up in the, I just don't understand why God does it this way. You could say that about a lot of things. You could say that about a lot of things. If you're going to use that argument, and I don't think there's a bunch of argument people in here, don't hear what I'm not saying, but these people who have these shallow arguments that limit them, I'm thinking if you don't understand why God does it, then you're going to say that about the whole Bible. Because God is God, and he's very secure in that. And he does it his way. And we want his way as long as we're comfortable with it. And we need his way when we're uncomfortable, because it's in the uncomfortable areas we're not trusting good yet. And if I can trust, look, if I can trust him with my tongue, I can trust him with my future. And if I can trust him with my heart, I think I'll trust him with my tongue. Because I'm telling you one thing, I know this much. When I got baptized in the Holy Spirit, I got turned loose on a life that I never dreamed would happen in this capacity. I had no idea just how much God would help me mature and learn how to use my tongue the way I'm supposed to. I never realized how much being filled with the Holy Spirit is also about knowing when to keep your tongue in your mouth and your teeth down and your lips closed. I had no idea that this tongue of fire that the Holy Spirit has would help me to defeat this tongue of lustful, out of control, anger, profanity, craziness that my mouth used to be. I had no idea that I could control it because I didn't control it at all at one time. But when you yield to the Holy Spirit, not only do you quit saying things that are stupid and unnecessary as you yield to him, but you understand why you don't need to say those things. And you can be quiet when everyone else is talking and it seems like you ought to be talking. Why aren't you talking? Because a lot of stuff's being said that don't need to be said. And you can be quiet. And then you can speak at the moment that you need to speak. And none of that stuff started happening in my life until I got baptized in the Holy Ghost. And just because God doesn't explain everything up front doesn't mean we should limit what's on the other end because we don't have all the answers to all the questions. I've got questions, 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 questions. But you know what I've done with most of my questions? I just lay them at his feet. One of the cool things is about growing in God and getting a little spiritual maturity in your life. I just lay it at his feet. And I say, well, I trust you with it. Glory be to God. And when I don't know how to pray, I shift into Holy Ghost gear. You ain't going to be around because I don't want to have to be concerned about what you understand and what you don't understand. And it's my personal time with God, but you're looking at one guy who agrees with the Apostle Paul. I am a Holy Ghost tongue-talking guy. But that's not what makes me so super spiritual. I pray in tongues because I need to. I pray in tongues because I want to. I pray in tongues because I get to. And that doesn't make me more, but it doesn't make you equipped equally if you limit yourself to what God tries to bring into your life. And one of my assignments in life is to let people know it is totally biblically acceptable. I will get in hot water with some preachers on this, but I don't care today. It is totally biblically acceptable to be a Baptist and baptized in the Holy Ghost and praying with other tongues. It is yes. It is totally biblically acceptable to be a born-again Catholic, baptized in the Holy Spirit and praying in other tongues. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm getting some funny looks. Put the Presbyterians in there. Put the Methodists in there. Folks, this is not a soapbox message. This is how the New Testament church was birthed, before there were any denominations or non-denoms. This is how the New Testament church was birthed. And what I love is that what, if you'll read the Bible, you understand, is that God took something that He meant to be a blessing and immediately began to use it in multiple ways. So in Acts chapter 2, you got personal edification. In Acts chapter 2, you got people praying in spirit together at one time. In Acts chapter 2, you got people hearing the gospel through people that are praying in tongues that don't know how to speak their language. And what they're praying is the wonderful works of God. And you got people asking questions that would have just blown off a good old sermon. There's a lot of people can cut off a good sermon real quick. I'm sorry, but a great song and a great sermon gets turned off by a lot of people. But when something supernatural like this happens, and the gospel comes to you in a different kind of a way, and you know it is supernatural, and it's very odd, and it's very unique, it's hard to turn that away. Most of them did not. 3,000 of them gave their lives to Jesus. Woo! Isn't that wonderful? That's awesome. That's awesome. But if you hadn't had the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, it'd just been another day at the shop. The Holy Spirit transcends language barrier. He does everything. One thing I'll tell you, and I'm going to stop. Just the amount of water left, it shows how much of the sermon is left. Oh God, he's just sipping. Hey, look, Eli had 4 wisdom teeth pulled, and he's sitting there on the front row. I told him he looked like his cousin, the one with the bigger jaws. I think it kind of makes you look better, though. I like you, man. I think you're looking good. But what blesses me is he's up here sicking me on this morning. This Holy Ghost blessing is real. I'm messing with you, buddy. But give God a shout. Let me close this mess. I was in Seoul, Korea, a place called Prayer Mountain. It's a place where people come from all over the world to seek the Lord. It's a place that was consecrated as a place to pray and seek God. And it was started by a church that became the world's largest local church in the world. I mean, totally. Yodo Full Gospel Church. In Seoul, Korea, who at one point, I don't know the current standings, but at one point was almost at 1 million members. Pretty awesome, isn't it? And so what they did is they built little what they call prayer grottas, which was like a little small, you can't really call it an apartment, it's like a little closet. And they just had little dugout places that they began many years ago, and then they, as they were blessed with more resources, they literally built little prayer type closets where you could open a little door, you knelt down, and you know the Asian people, most of them are smaller anyway. So Quinn, you and I would, it's an effort. And I remember crawling there. It's got a little place to kneel, got a little lamp. a screen on a window there, and that's it. And you go there to pray. While I crawled into that little prayer grotto, my purpose for going there is I'd heard so much about it. I didn't believe I had to go to a certain mountain to hear God or touch God. But there'd been so many churches changed there, so many lives changed, so many things shifted, and God did amazing things as people would come in desperation to find God, and God would visit people because of their extreme sacrifice, and they're searching for Him and yearning and longing for Him and reveal Himself to them. And I'm there that day because I'm not going to go to that part of the world and experience one of the greatest churches that's ever existed, the largest local church in the body of Christ. By the way, I think it's wonderful that the largest churches in the world are all Holy Ghost churches. All of them. The biggest ones are. That's how they got that way. Now that doesn't mean that anything God's doing is a bad thing. I just thought I would acknowledge that to you. Because there's certain growth that can only come by the Holy Ghost. And there's certain places around this world the persecution is so severe. Comfortable American church. I don't know what some Americans would do. I mean, there are people that they, to serve God, they're threatened. Their life is threatened always. Anyhow, I love our country, but let me move on. I remember I'm sitting there and I'm folded up in there. And I'm praying and I'm seeking the Lord. And the Lord spoke to me and He said, "Hush and listen." And I just sort of leaned my head back. And I began to hear people praying. And there were a bunch of people on that mountain praying. But I really wasn't listening to everybody else till the Lord nudged me to listen. And He didn't give me an audible voice. He just spoke out loud on the inside to me, like He does to you. How many of you value His voice? Maybe you're in this room and you'd love to be able to differentiate His voice in your life. Well, that's how you start. You want to. You want to hear His voice. That's a good starting place. Ain't nobody going to shame you there. Because it's the surefire way to never hear Him is to not care. But that you want Him is a beautiful thing. And my head's laying back and I'm hearing people. It sounds like Russian. It sounds like German. I hear French. I hear Spanish. I think I hear some African dialects. And none of those people are praying to be heard by me. But to hear them crying out to God without fear. And then all of a sudden, I begin to hear their languages change. I begin to hear someone in French. And the moment they went into praying in the Spirit, I knew. I knew. Someone praying in Spanish. And suddenly, they shift and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. And I'm listening and I'm thinking, Lord, thank You for not letting me miss this. Thank You for showing me that You've got a plan that's so big. A plan that if man doesn't just determine to shove You away, You've got a strategy, You've got a plan, You've got a move to bring this world to You that will say yes. And then in Acts chapter 2, and I'm sitting there and I keep listening to that and I'm amazed because I'm hearing the difference. And I begin to think about as I close this message. I got to come out of the illustration and close this message. But I feel like I'm in both places right now. Because I feel like I did right now sitting on that mountain. Because Peter starts preaching that day on the day of Pentecost. And it's all in Acts chapter 2. We're just in this early part of this great book. The book of action. The book of Acts. And he says, these are not drunk as you suppose, seeing as this is but the third hour of the day. He said, but this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, saying that in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. That's black flesh. That's brown flesh. That's yellow flesh. That's white flesh. That's freckle flesh. That's poor flesh. That's bound flesh. That's loosed flesh. That's educated flesh. That's uneducated flesh. That's angry flesh. That's happy flesh. God is pouring out of His Spirit upon all flesh. What man couldn't do, and what our best efforts couldn't do, and our skills and trainings that at different times God uses, because He does use those things, couldn't do. He's got one more mighty move. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it's His move. It's His touch. It's His wind. It's His Spirit. Would you stand all over the room, please? I preached longer than I meant to. Excuse me. My body's kicking off crud. I'd love to get back there and lay hands on you today, but I've been coughing on my hands and I don't want y'all grabbing for your masks. I'm playing. I love you. I tell you, I might not put my hands on you right now, but I'm going to put my faith on you. Hallelujah. Lord, I love these people. And I know that I'm not just speaking to our on-campus family, but I'm speaking to on-campus loved ones. Online campus loved ones and guests and friends. And Father, I know that even some leaders that in so many ways are such a better leader than me. So many ways. Yet they need your power and they need your presence and they need your Spirit. And they have been limited. They've been limited by wrong voices. And they've been limited by embracing some things beyond what the Bible says. And I thank you that today they open their hearts to give place to you. I declare that seeds of Pentecostal outpouring, Holy Spirit outpouring, because Pentecost is not just what a church puts on the side of its wall of its church. Pentecost is not just a banner that somebody like me walks in. I am a Pentecostal preacher. I've always been one. I don't go around like I'm, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. But I'm Pentecostal not because of anything other than I yield to the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost is not, He's not oneness, He's not three, He's not 10, He's not 50. He's not all these twists of doctrine that some people get hung up in. He is the absolute presence of God on the earth today. And as He moves in this place today, and as He moves in this service today, He will fill every blood-washed child of God with more. And if you don't know Jesus, He's drawing you toward Jesus right now to save you. It is the same wonderful Holy Spirit carrying out every good act of God today. And that's wonderful news. Because it's the Lord, the Holy Spirit, carrying some things out that we wouldn't let anybody else touch. But when you realize it's Him, when it's His Spirit touching your spirit, all of a sudden these happenings need to be happening in you. These happenings that happened on that day can be happening in us. These happenings were not something that happened for a season of time like some bad teaching has declared. These happenings are continued to be happenings that touch every generation. I want my kids operating in this. I want my grandson and my granddaughter operating in this. I want my friends and my families, family friends and other families, but they're part of my family in the sense of relationship. I want them operating in this. James, lift up your hands, brother. Father, I pray for his body right now. In the name of Jesus. I was just about to pray over these people, but Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for quickening his body and bringing him the rest of the way out of this struggle, that his body recovers from that stroke that he went through, that stamina and strength and recovery flow in his body divinely and wonderfully today in the name of Jesus. Now, church family, lift your hands all over this room. Father, I pray for the wind of your spirit. I pray for the move of your spirit. I pray that every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, every teenager, every child on this campus will experience more of you, and that we learn that everything about you is beautiful. And everything about you is priceless. Everything about you is to be honored and valued. Everything that you give is good. Even the mysterious parts of you, that especially makes you good, because that just means you are bigger than logic. You're bigger than all my questions and my fears and my shortcomings. You're God, and you've got it all. You've got it all covered in the expanse of your spirit. And when we receive your mighty outpourings, things change. Father, I thank you that in the name of Jesus, that every person in this house that opens their heart to you, that they're going to begin to give place to you in their lives. Some of them, it's going to happen when it's just you and them, because that's the way it needs to happen, because you are the great convincer. Some of them, it's going to be in a prayer meeting. Some of them, it's going to be today. Yes. Some of them, it's going to happen this evening. Glory be to God and the Lamb forever. I've got this picture etched in my mind of what it must have been like in the upper room in Jerusalem when those disciples were sitting there, and suddenly heaven changed everything. And they began to pray in the power of the Holy Spirit, and they immediately got up and began to go forward by the Spirit. They didn't know by themselves any more than they knew before he fell. But when he came, everything they needed to know was now in them in a different way, and they would know what they needed to know how to do and be when they needed to know how to do and be the way he wanted them to do, as they just gave way to this new life in the Spirit. Something about that kind of life that can't nobody get the glory but God. Maybe that's what makes it so beautiful. And maybe that's what makes it even so necessary. I welcome it because my pride all but wrecked me. I don't want my pride to wreck me anymore. I need that kind of leadership. When this whole thing's said and done, I want to be able to look at the Lord and say, Lord, you blew this way and I went with the wind. You released fire here, and I believed for oil to keep that fire burning. That I can say, Lord, everything you did, I tried to flow with it and not fight it. And everything you fought, I wanted to fight with you. And everything you loved, I love it too. And everything that you resisted, I chose to resist it as well. And how can we have that courage, and how can we know to do that? By his Spirit that he said, I will pour out. And he said, by the way, and whoever calls upon my name shall be saved. And everybody right now, for the benefit of whoever doesn't yet know Jesus, before I release you to go, because I want you to come back this evening. I want you to support these young men. I want you to give place to God. I want you to make the most of this revival weekend. So I'm not going to try to do everything in one moment. My job today as your apostle and pastor is just to sow seeds of Pentecostal happenings. But right now, for everyone that needs to say yes to Christ, everyone pray this with me. Father God, the name of Jesus, I repent of my sin. I ask that you would forgive me, that you would come into my life. Thank you for taking extreme measures to reach me. It took something different, and I'm sorry for that. But I love you, and I'm grateful that you love me enough to do the untraditional, to do the different, to do the supernatural, to touch my life. You love me like that. I will live my life loving you. I choose to live for you with all that I am. I receive you today. I profess you today. I confess you today. And I love you today. In Jesus' name. Would you give the Lord a hand clap, everybody? May the Lord bless you all and keep you. May the Lord cause His countenance to shine upon you. May the Lord establish in all His ways as they become your ways more and more. And may He grant you peace. I look forward to seeing you this evening. May you have a great, great lunch. And may there be some great conversation about Holy Ghost things in your life. 6:30 this evening. 6:30. Thank you for the reminder, team.